먹고 있죠.
Please be seated.
Président, veuillez vous asseoir.
The court is now back in session.
Reprise de l'audience.
Once again, the floor is given to the prosecution so that they can present the key documents before the chamber. You may proceed.
Présentation des documents.
Thank you, Mr. President. Good afternoon, everyone. I hope that everyone's managing to stay awake. Can I please start this afternoon's session by referring to a document that I neglected to cover this morning? The document is E3/114. It is a Funk publication, again published in Nouvelle du Cambodge, and the first entry is dated the 6th of April 1974. English ERN 00280550, French 000. 00088 and Khmer 00662247. And the document has the following heading.
Le document porte le titre suivant.
The flag of prestige, dignity and honor of the nation and people of Kampuchea, the National United Front of Kampuchea, FUNK, and of the Royal Government of National Union of Kampuchea, GRUNK, is flying high in the international arena. There is then text that reports that the delegation led by Khieu Samphan and Ieng Sary is on an official visit to a number of brother-friendly countries, including the Democratic Republic of Vietnam, the People's Republic of China, and the People's Democratic Republic of Korea. On the next page, which is English ERN 00280551, French 000000088, which is the same page as the previous extract, and one page on in Khmer to S00662248. There is the following quotation. These visits have attained such a great level of animation and solemnity and have had such a great impact on world opinion among friends and foes alike, because the FUNK and GRUNK delegation led by Khieu Samphan and Mr. Ieng Sary represents the nation and the people of Kampuchea, the movement for the fight for national liberation against American imperialists on what is currently the most active front in the world, as well as the movement for a totally independent and sovereign struggle with no dependency whatsoever on any foreign country, and which takes into its own hands the destiny of its country and people. FUNK and GRUNK are the authentic representatives of the movement for the struggle for liberation of a small country that is the victim of the cruelest and most barbaric aggression, but which is about to triumph over American imperialist aggressors, the ringleaders of international imperialism. Staying within the same document, I move to English ERN 00280556. Khmer 00662258 and French 00000093/94. The extract has this as the heading.
Voici le titre.
The Phnom Penh traitors are in total disarray and are cornered on the defensive on all fronts, while FAPLNK remain on the offensive, attacking the enemy without respite. And then further on the page. But when they were exposed in Phnom Penh, FAPLNK launched on an assault on the 14th of March against positions on the Koh Tak Islands and Ok Na Tae on the Mekong River, 6 kilometres from the Royal Palace Phnom Penh. In one day and one night, they liberated the islands, wiped out an enemy battalion, and helped 50,000 people to cross over to the liberated zone. And just beneath that, this extract. A day later, on March the 15th, FAPLNK again launched a swift and surprise attack on the city of Udong. On the 18th of March, it says 1874, Udong was totally liberated. An enemy division was totally wiped out, and 30,000 inhabitants of that town and surrounding areas successfully crossed over to the liberated zone. It is only after FAPLNK had totally destroyed the military positions, the administrative power, detention camps, the pacification centres at Udong, that the traitors rushed reinforcement troops to recapture the town of Udong. But they too were totally trounced and decimated in great numbers. Next, please, can I move to document number E3/2728. English 0039-0921. Khmer 00602506 and French 00602498. This relates to a statement given by Pol Pot in Beijing on the 3rd of October 1977. The extract reads as follows under the title Pol Pot on Evacuation of Cambodian City Residents. Pol Pot gave a press conference in Peking on the 3rd of October, as reported by the NCNA, in which he spoke of the victories won in various fields by the Cambodian people under the leadership of the party. One important factor in the success of the Revolutionary War in Cambodia, he was reported as saying, had been the evacuation of city residents to the countryside, This had been decided in February 1975, quote, because we knew that before the smashing of all sorts of enemy spy organizations, our strength was not strong enough to defend the revolutionary regime. The enemy's secret agent network, lying low in our country, was very massive and complicated. But when we crushed them, it was difficult for them to stage a comeback. Their forces were scattered in various cooperatives, which are in our grip. Thus, we have the initiative in our hands. The enemy dare not attack from outside. Close quote. The next document is from the Phibis collection for March 1975. The English ERN is 00413180. There are no Khmer and French translations, but they have been requested. This is a telegram forming part of the US Department of State records for March 1975. And this document is a telegram from the American Embassy in Rome to Washington. And it states as follows. Vatican's Deputy Secretary of State, Archbishop Benelli, called Illing to his office morning March 15, and this is 1975, to inform him that Pope Paul, deeply anguished over situation in Cambodia. Apostolic delegate in Saigon, Archbishop Lemaître, has sent reports to Vatican in the last few days, which indicate that Khmer Rouge are wantonly massacring innocent civilians in areas they have recently conquered. These reports from Lemaître, based on information obtained from Catholic clergy in combat areas, as well as from other sources. The next document is D366/7, point 1, point 366.
The President, Mr. Co-Prosecutor, could you please hold on and counsel for Mr. Kilson Pond in the seat?
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à l'ensemble de la Chambre et à l'ensemble des partis. Et je prie mon confrère de bien vouloir m'excuser de l'interrompre. Mais j'ai un problème au sujet de ce document qui est présenté aujourd'hui comme un document clé. C'est un document qui ne figure ni en note de bas de page de l'ordonnance de clôture, ni sur aucune liste des partis. Et dans ces conditions, s'il n'y a pas eu de requête comme nouveau document, je pense que nous ne pouvons pas l'évoquer aujourd'hui dans le cadre de la présentation des documents clés du bureau des coprocureurs. Donc, j'objecte à ce stade-ci que l'on puisse l'évoquer comme document clé.
Mr. President, can I explain the history of this document?
Le procureur, j'aimerais...
Firstly, it is in the closing order footnotes. Secondly, it was part of 50 documents that the defense of Ying Seri had picked as not having been subject to debates. prior to the admissibility hearing.
Plutôt que selon
Thirdly,
la liste de l'Insérie,
it was then in the Insérie list for debate.
De la recevabilité. Puis,
and that was on an occasion when the OCP asked
pour
the
débat.
Trial chamber to exclude 24 documents that had not been debated upon.
Qui pas fait l'objet de débat.
This document, Mr. President, was then in a list provided to all
ensuite,
parties in an email, and no objection was stated
aucune
to this document.
N'avait été faite.
As far as I understand it, this document is still
liste.
Waiting a final
sache,
decision from the trial chamber,
le
but it's one that I do seek to rely on as being of particular relevance in this case. If I read the document to you and you decide
pertinent.
In due course it is admissible and relevant, then it's on the case file. If you decide, having heard this document, for whatever reason it's inadmissible, it's not on the case file. But the prosecution do respectfully submit that this is a highly relevant document of particular importance. It is dated the 17th of March 1975, that is 1 month prior to the evacuation. So I repeat, my respectful submission is that it should be referred to and the Chamber then decide upon relevance.
Mr.
President.
Mr. President.
Une question adressée à Monsieur le coprocureur. À quelle note de bas de page de l'ordonnance de clôture se trouve ce document? Parce que nous avons cherché et nous avons effectivement vu ce document auquel s'objectait à l'époque notre confrère de l'équipe de Yang Sari. Et par erreur, parce que nous avons vérifié, il a cité ce document comme figurant à la note de page 377 de l'ordonnance de clôture. Or, ce document n'y figure pas. Nous avons vérifié. Donc là, encore une fois, ce document ne figure pas à la note de bas de page 377. Si Monsieur le coprocureur a un autre élément à nous fournir, mais encore une fois, il ne figure pas dans le cadre des notes de bas de page de l'ordonnance de clôture. Et s'il a été indiqué par erreur par la suite par mon confrère de l'équipe Yang Sari qui y était, ce n'est pas le cas. Donc ça ne... Effectivement, votre décision est pendante là-dessus. Et parce qu'elle est pendante, je pense qu'on ne peut pas présenter ce document comme étant un document clé à ce stade.
This document cannot be presented as a key document at this stage of the proceedings.
Mr. President, it's absolutely fair that my learned friend should ask for the footnote. I'm trying to do a search at the moment on case map to check this. And can I say that the information I'm passing to the court that it is in a closing order footnote was passed to me by one of my fellow counsel. So can I suggest this, Mr. President, that I move on? I know that others in my team will try and obtain the closing order footnote, and perhaps if we could come back to this in a few moments' time.
President, yes,
laissons
do so.
De côté. Jusqu'à ce que nous
Thank you, Mr. President. I move now on to document number E3/3295.
Le procureur. Je passe donc au document E3/3295.
This is a report of a Chinese journalist's delegation to Cambodia.
Un rapport d'une délégation de journalistes chinois au Cambodge.
And the first extract is on English page 00419155. Khmer 00751899 and French 00756905-6. So this is the report from the Chinese journalists, and the first extract is as follows. One day towards the end of March, and this is March 1975, we visited the Phnom Penh Front headquarters. We were warmly received, and guests and hosts chatted about friendship and discussed the victorious situation of the impending liberation of Phnom Penh. During our visit, we were received at one forward position by Khieu Samphan, Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of National Defence of the Royal Government of National Union of Cambodia and Commander-in-Chief of the People's Armed Forces of National Liberation of Cambodia. We enjoyed a very cordial and friendly conversation with him. Hu Yun, Minister of the Interior, Cooperatives and Communal Reforms, and Hu Nim, Minister of Information and Propaganda, also received the delegation and honoured it at a banquet in the name of the National United Front of Cambodia and the Cabinet. In another section, still with the same pages, this extract. The Chinese journalists' delegation reluctantly left the heroic Cambodian people and the beautiful land of Cambodia as the good news came pouring in that the People's Armed Forces had liberated Niek Lung and taken Pochentong Airport. We all felt that the liberation of Phnom Penh was imminent. But as the monsoons were settling in and would make travel difficult, we felt we must return home. On our way, we heard the good news of Phnom Penh's liberation on April the 17th. We jubilantly raised our arms in salute to the historic great victory of the fraternal Cambodian people. The next document is E3/27. This is the first OCIJ questioning between Khieu Samphan and the investigating judges. The relevant question by co-investigating judge Marcel Lemond appears at English page 00156743. This is Khmer page 00156614 and French page 00156666. And Judge Lemond asked the following question. Where did you come from? With whom were you living beforehand? Answer. For about 10 days, I had been at the headquarters of Pol Pot to the west of Udong. I would like to assert that I did not participate in the work of the headquarters. I was just present in the headquarters and observed the events upon which Pol Pot briefed me once in a while. Question. Who else was present with you at that time? I think that there were just the two of us. I'm now moving, Mr. President, to a theme I identified in the introduction, which is moving on to statements made by Ying Seri about the evacuation. The next document is E3/611. It is an article published in the Chicago Tribune on the 18th of July, 1978. It's written by a journalist, Ronald Yates.
Écrit par un journaliste dénommé Ronald Yates.
Suri did admit to the wholesale denuding of Cambodian cities, adding that some two-thirds of the population has been shifted arbitrarily to the countryside and into several new economic zones and cooperatives. Quote, we have no reason to massacre our own people, close quote, Suri said. The next document is E3/550. This is an article published in the Newsweek magazine on the 8th of September 1975. The journalist involved was a man called Pringle.
Journaliste s'appelait Pringle.
So this is a question from Pringle to Ying Suri.
C'est une question de Pringle à Ying Suri.
Why did your forces
evacuate
the population of Phnom Penh after they captured the capital on April
17?
Ying Suri.
Ying Suri.
There were two reasons.
Il y avait deux raisons.
The first of which was food.
La première était la nourriture.
We thought there were 2 million people in
Phnom Penh.
But when we entered, we discovered 3 million.
Nous avons découvert qu'il y en avait 3 million.
Pringle asked, what was the second reason? Ying Suri's answer. We discovered a document detailing a secret political military plan by the US Central Intelligence Agency and the defeated Lon Nol regime to spread
confusion
after our victory. The next document is E169/4.1.1.1. The first extract is on English page 0081-5131, French 0081-5912, and Khmer 0080-9797. This is an extract from Revolutionary Male and Female Youths, number 7, July 1975. We have now arrived in a new era of the democratic revolution. We have liberated the entire country. We have controlled over the state authority countrywide. The Kampuchea society has become the new society in which no one can oppress another. There is neither rich nor poor, and there is no oppressive class and no oppressed class. All Kampuchean people live equally and do the laborious work together to produce food, to support their living, and to defend and rebuild the country together. This is the new trait of the Kampuchea society. Within the same document, English one page further, so ERN 00815133, the Khmer page 0080-9799. And the French, I hope, is one page on, so 0081-5913. If the party had taken no measures to evacuate all the people out of Phnom Penh and other provincial towns. The enemy might have attacked and pounced on us from behind and smash our revolutionary forces to pieces. Or at least, the enemy would have been able to burrow inside our revolutionary stance, cause chaos in the revolutionary ranks, break up the party's discipline and solidarity, making the revolutionary stance fade away. And then the enemy could have smashed us in any day to dissolve our historical great victory of the 17th of April. Next, I move to document number E3/622. This is a document dated the 14th of June 1978, and it reflects a broadcast entitled Kampuchean Delegation in Japan. So this was published in the Los Angeles Times.
Délégation Kampuchéenne au Japon, article du Los Angeles Times.
And it's quoting what Ying Sari is telling the journalist.
Ce qu'a dit Ying Sari au journaliste.
And what the journalist is reporting. Refugees reaching Thailand have said thousands of people died when the Cambodian regime drove most of the population of Phnom Penh into the countryside without adequate training or equipment for farming. Yugoslav journalists and Swedish diplomats who toured Cambodia this spring said Phnom Penh, the capital, appeared nearly empty. But Ieng Sary denied this, saying, quote, about 200,000 people live in the capital. Of course, the evacuation of Phnom Penh was originally a temporary measure. However, the people are now satisfied with country life and they do not want to return to the city, Ieng Sary said. The Deputy Prime Minister said he did not know how many people died in the evacuation. He said stories of thousands of people being killed were, quote, fabrications intended to defame democratic Kampuchea, close quote. After the war ended, he said, 85% of our people became sick with malaria and could not walk. That was the reason for the evacuation of Phnom Penh. It was a necessary measure in order to prevent people from dying. Close quote. He said most of the malaria cases had been cured.
Que la plupart de ceux qui souffraient du paludisme.
The next document is E3/624. This is a document that was published in the New York Times,
publié dans le New York Times,
29th of July 1978. It's entitled Belgrade, Yugoslavia, 28th of July. The heading is Cambodian defends 1975 closing of nation to prevent a civil war.
Le titre est le
and
suivant.
The text reads as follows.
Défend le bouclage de la nation
Cambodia's foreign minister, Ieng Sary, said today that the closing of his country and evacuation of Phnom Penh after the communists took over in 1975 had been necessary, quote, because otherwise we would have had a civil war. Our complexities and difficulties would have been greater, he said, and more would have died. There would have been a civil war, and that would open the door to neighbors to intervene. And then on the same page, this extract. The difficulty of supplying rice to the people of Phnom Penh was the reason initially given for the evacuation of the capital, and Mr. Ieng Sary repeated it. But he also said, for the first time, that the revolutionaries considered the city to be full of agents, ammunition dumps, and conspiracies to undermine the new regime, and therefore felt total evacuation to be necessary for defense. I move on now, Mr. President, to some speeches of Kyu Sampong. And the first document is D366, stroke 7, point 1, point 14. This is an extract from a publication written by Stephen Hedder, entitled Pol Pot and Kyu Sampong. The relevant English ERN is 0008-7771. There are no documents in Khmer and French. I have asked for translations to be done. The document is headed with this heading, Kyu Sampong and the Liberation. And Steve Hedder says as follows.
Je cite Steve Hedder.
In what appears to have been a calculated abuse of the trust in which he was held, Kyu Sampong actively helped, just before the end of the war, to set up Lon Nol military personnel and civil servants for easy execution. The esteem in which he was held meant that some of them allowed themselves to become sitting ducks for murder. Thus, as the Communist Party of Kampuchea advanced towards an all-out military victory during the first 4 months of 1975, Kyu Sampong twice signaled those who had been fighting against it that only the seven top leaders among them would be executed upon defeat. On the 24th/25th February, Kyu Sampong chaired the Second National Congress, a meeting of members of GRUNC who resided inside the country, and 273 representatives of FUNC associations and the army. The Congress declared that the seven traitors must die, but that other high-ranking Khmer Republic personalities could join the Sihanouk side. I interject here to explain that there is a FIBIS extract dealing with the order to kill the seven traitors. It's been referred to a number of times. That is the FIBIS extract for the 26th of February 1975, that is E3/117. To continue with Mr. Hedder's words. Then, on the 1st of April 1975, a little more than 2 weeks before Phnom Penh was captured, Kyu Sampong spoke in a live broadcast over the Communist Party-run radio.
À la radio.
He attacked the seven traitors by name, but appealed to the officers and men of the Khmer Republic armed forces to lay down their arms and join the Sihanouk side. Mr. President, that broadcast of the 1st of April 1975 is document number E3/118. I move next to documentation dealing with the second forced movement. And the first document is E3/216. The first extract is on English 0085-0974, Khmer 0000-8487, and French 003-433-75. And this is an extract from the record of the Standing Committee's visit to the zone on the 20th to the 24th of August 1975. The heading is Situation of Economy and Crops Diversification. There is a heading Rice Planting. This has been pushed everywhere. Rice is planted on the old land and is also planted on some other land. Planting rice, brackets, sowing and transplanting, close bracket, has been finished in most places in Battambang. Many paddy fields have canals and raised embankments. Water problem has been brought to an extent under mastery. The next extract, English 0085-0975. Khmer 0000-8488-89 and French 0034-3376 under the heading Ankar's Guiding Opinions, National Defense Affairs. Concretely, it is imperative to strengthen and expand the cooperatives, employing the strength of the cooperatives as the core, making them the hard core for the absorption of the new people. And on the same page, the function of cooperatives since the total liberation is to absorb all the new people coming out of all the cities and towns, especially Phnom Penh City and in the northwest Battambang. Every type of horrible element exists among the hundreds of thousands of new people in Battambang, but the cooperatives have absorbed them completely, supplying them with food and, moreover, deploying their strength to work. Therefore, the cooperatives must be further strengthened and expanded. We move to English page 0085-0976, Khmer 0000-8490 and French 0034-3377-78. The question is posed, how must we sort things out? The people have hope. In the northwest zone, the characteristics of the terrain are extremely favorable, which they can clearly see. The base people are extremely happy, while the new people are happy, whereas in the northwest, there's lots of hope. One or 2 years from now, the standard of living will rise. The cooperatives will astound as the paddy fields and water situation are transformed, and good supply will be abundant and everyone comfortable, and then it will rise even higher. The same document I move to English 0085-0977. Khmer 00-00-8491-92 and French 00-34-33-78-79 under the heading Economy and Crop Diversification. The party's direction is to diversify crops and build up the country. Workforce must be allocated to those who have free land to plant and diversify crops. Workforce must be provided to any place with more work ability. Therefore, the northern zone and the northwest zone, and especially the northwest, have the most good qualities in terms of the geography of paddy land, which is good and of which there is a lot of surplus, and they must receive more people. Second, possess capital in the form of rice with which they can sustain new people. Third, they have capital in terms of various kinds of implements. We are carrying out shock assaults to diversify crops in the northwest zone in order to improve people's living conditions throughout the country, to find new capital for purchasing materials to be used in building the country and diversifying agricultural and industrial production. If we send workforce to other places with less work ability, we will lose both flute and drum, time and effort. In doing so, our fighting guideline is not right. So we must fight at the right place, where it is effective, because we carry out the policy of self-reliance. We must find capital on our own. And under a subheading, workforce arrangement. The northwest zone has favourable and unfavourable conditions as follows. Favourable conditions, in general, the land is fertile and also good without using fertilisers. The area is a huge plain with no mountains, easy for us to organise the workforce to do ploughing and to use water. There is also workforce existing. It is better if adding up more force to the zone. The existing force also has experience in diversifying crops. There are some machinery and tools. Under a subheading shortfall, or points to be considered. Firstly, not yet in mastery of water problem, and second, its human being strength is insufficient. The labour force must be increased. 300,000 or 400,000 more would not be enough. The current strength of 1 million persons can only work 50%. It's imperative to add 400,000 or 500,000 more. The next document is E3/781. This is a CPK document dated September 1975. The first extract is Khmer 00072367, French 00543745, and English 00523569. The heading of the document is Examination of Control and Implementation of the Policy Line on Restoring the Economy and Preparations to Build the Country in Every Sector.
Du développement du pays dans tous les domaines.
There is then a subheading.
Ensuite,
Control and Implementation of the Party's Policy Line to Build Agriculture.
Objective.
To examine the control of, the absorption of, and the implementation of the party's agricultural line to push agriculture to expand in a great leap to the maximum according to the instructions of the party. A little bit lower on the same page. We must quickly prepare to transform from backward agriculture to modern within 10 to 15 years. This is the objective. If we look at this time-wise, we see that as being very fast. The next page, English 00523570, Khmer 00072368, French 00543745. These objectives are set at a very high level. We must really work urgently to achieve these objectives. This matter demands the preparation of forces in every sector to really be orchestrated. Machinery, fertilizer, water, etc. Furthermore, we have cooperatives, which are the property of the collective. It is easy to arrange everything. Today, we have only people's cooperative ownership and state ownership. Within the same document, English ERN 00523574, Khmer 00072373, French 00543749-50. Where must we assemble the forces of the people? We must do this wherever the soil is good, fertile and favourable, not where it is difficult and not good. On the next page, in Battambang in 1976, we must have water in every lowland sector because the majority of that low-lying land has regular water sources. Moving to English ERN 00523576, Khmer 00072376, French 00543752. Estimates are that today's labour force numbers 5 million. These forces have been moved to do various work, and there now remain 4,700,000 people. Use some of them in producing rubber, sugarcane, and there still remain 4 million. We must work 3 million hectares of land. If we expand, then 4 million. English ERN, still within the same document, 00523580, Khmer 00072382, French 00543755 through 56. In Sector 15, we must have the goal of using 30,000 to 40,000 people to work along Highway 5. At this site, we can get 1 ton per hectare. In the northwest, we can get 3 to 4 tons. Within the same document, English RN 0052359090, Khmer 0072397, French 0054372, I'll repeat again the French RN 0054376. In the northwest, we must add an additional force of 500,000 people. Prayer Vihear has requested 50,000 first. In Prayer Vihear, there is the possibility of solving food supplies. Prayer Vihear has 70,000 old people already, so send 20,000 first as we go along. Keeping the same pages, save for English 0052359191, it continues. In the north, they need people to be given to Kampong Thom province. The east also needs forces to be given to sectors which are short of people. So each zone must make appropriate preparations and not let things sway back and forth, allocating how many to upper level and moving how many to other locations. The next document is E190. Point 1.318. It is an article written by the journalist William Shawcross. It was published in the Far Eastern Economic Review on the 2nd of January 1976. The first extract is at Khmer page S0070875 73 and French 0070501 5. The English is S0005151. Grow. Everything, declares the radio. Particular attention must be paid to rice, for rice means everything. Rice means steel, factories, energy, fuel, and tractors. In some places, Prayer Vihear, for instance, conditions have been bad. Even so, the current crop is hailed as the greatest ever, although it was planted late, at the end of April and throughout May, by an unskilled and unwilling labor force. Ying Sari told the Thais that Cambodia was determined to become self-sufficient in rice, and one of the means appears to have been a second great uprooting of people. Refugees say that in the past 2 months, up to 300,000 evacuees from Phnom Penh have been moved again, this time to Battambang province. The journey was apparently made partly by boat and partly by train. Just enough people were left behind in the provinces south and east of Phnom Penh to harvest the rice that they and their fellows had planted in the early summer. The rest have been sent to the country's most fertile region, in order to extend the area of next year's dry season crop. The next document, and this is three to go. The next document is D199/26.2.184. This is a document published through the French Press Agency.
Il s'agit d'un document émanant de l'agence France Presse.
It is a document entitled
dont le titre est
Cambodia, the New York Times Cambodge. Reports new and forced movements with a high death toll.
De
English ERN 00519810. Khmer 00548749. French 00389829. In a dated dispatch from the small Thai border town of Arayan Pratep, the New York Times reported Wednesday that hundreds of thousands of Cambodians are being again moved from one part of the country to another, and that many of them have died during these very rigorous journeys. Most of the people are being shifted to the sparsely populated and underdeveloped province of Battambang. According to one refugee who escaped from his country on the 6th of January, a great many of these migrants, most of whom are peasants, are suffering from malaria, typhoid, cholera, and dysentery. The refugee, a male nurse aged 33 years, said that 600 refugees died within a month of their arrival in the region of Phnom Srok, where he was staying. The Daily writes that this new movement, which rivals in scale to the one that occurred in Phnom Penh last April, apparently began in late October or early November. According to testimonies gathered by the New York Times, deportees are often not allowed to eat anything other than rice and are escorted by armed soldiers. Those who travel by train are packed inside freight cars like fish inside a can, according to a refugee. Other migrants travel to their new destination on foot, in ox-drawn carts, or in lorries. A great many of the migrants have died either of disease or of exhaustion during the journey, which often lasts for many days. Next, document number E3/1181. This again is a CPK document. It is entitled General View of Sector 5, Northwest Zone. And it is dated the 27th of June 1977. English ERN 00223175, Khmer 00214486, and French 00612289. It moves into the next pages as well. General view of individual districts. Tmapuk. The majority of the population was liberated on the 1st of February 1975, and most of them, almost 100%, are post-17 April people. Item 2 on English page 002231176, Kamaya 002144489, and French 006122290. Sisyphon District. The district population is 50,000. Almost 100% of them are new people. Later in the list, Pom Shrok, there is a population of 70,000. Base people amount to approximately 300 families. Approximately 50,000 people have come from Phnom Penh. Local new people consist of more than 20,000. At item 4, the next area is Preah Net Preah. The population of Preah Net Preah prior to the 17th of April was 150 families. More than 70,000 have come from Phnom Penh. And on English 002231177, Khmer 002144490, and French 006122292. There is the following extract. It is the worst place of starvation, which last year alone killed more than 20,000 people. The final document in this presentation, save for submissions that may have to be made in respect of the document which my learned friend Ms. Guisset has addressed, is This document is E3/3316. It is a release from Amnesty International. It is a news release published in New York on the 30th of March 1978. And the extract reads as follows. Some observers had pointed out that it is possible many people became missing due to forcible transfer to work in remote areas. Until recently, there were reports of constant forced migration. Mr. President, can I please address the document that we were looking at?
Lointaine jusqu'à récemment, il était fait état de migration forcée incessante.
I'm having confirmation sent by email from others in my office, Mr. President, that despite my earlier comments, I'm having confirmation that this document was not referred to in the closing order or in our final submission, that it was also not in our Rule 80 documents list. Can I say this, Mr. President, that given the fact that the status of this document has not yet been ruled finally on by the trial chamber, can I make, on behalf of OCP now, an oral application pursuant to Rule 87.4 for that to go on the case file? I understand, of course, you will consider in due course whether this document is admissible or not admissible. If admissible, we obviously invite you to have regard to its contents. Mr. President, that concludes my presentation from the OCP. Can I simply say this in conclusion, that I was intending to send to all my learned friends and to the court an index of this presentation so that everyone could see which documents had been referred to and what the ERNs were for each document. I've not actually had the time to discuss that with my learned friends yet. That had been my proposal. That's intended to help everyone in court to identify these documents. I don't know if my learned friends have any objections to that being done. Thank you.
Pour leur consultation, je ne sais pas s'il y a une objection à cette pratique.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Je voudrais savoir si la Chambre souhaite que nous répondions à l'application, la requête de, en demande de versement de documents nouveaux faite par Monsieur le Co-procureur sur le document pour lequel nous avions une objection. Est-ce que la Chambre souhaite que nous répondions maintenant ou elle souhaite que nous fassions notre réponse par écrit? C'est la question que je pose, puisque, si je comprends bien, il y a confirmation de ce que nous disions tout à l'heure dans le cadre de notre objection. Et il y a une requête nouvelle pour laquelle aucune des parties du côté de la défense n'a été entendue. Donc je souhaite la position de la Chambre sur ce point afin de savoir comment faire, comment procéder.
To that application. So I wish to know how you would like us to proceed, Mr. President.
President, the chamber would like to inform Kisampan Defense that you may use the time allocation that the chamber has granted to you so that you can make your observation or comments regarding the documents presented by the prosecution or any other parties. And of course, we will look at the actual time that might be needed by Kiev's post defense when the time comes. The time is now appropriate for a short break. We will take 20 minutes break and we return at 5:05. The court is now in recess.
Suspension de l'audience.